So first of all, I just want to thank you all for coming to our little Goddess in the Garden gathering at the Stone House. This is the first or maybe the third of many. Yaj, known as the Relationship Goddess, took a break from conducting ancient martial healing rituals.
Marital.
Ooh, that was an interesting
faux pas. Yeah, it's okay, I can correct.
Ancient marital.
Yeah, martial marital.
Oh, yeah, that's good.
Sometimes it's close together.
Exactly. Rituals so that she could talk to us tonight at the Stone House. For 14 years, Yaz has been a licensed marriage and family therapist in private practice. She has a BS in health education from Hunter College and a master's in family system counseling from Bastyr University in Seattle. Yaz's topic tonight is excellent communication and how to have it in all relationships. She knows a great deal on the subject and has helped thousands of couples and individuals with her work. And the same communication principles she teaches her clients helped her discover her own marriage was a fundamental mismatch. Still using these conscious communication with her ex, she is now happily separated, cooperative co-parent, and reinvented businesswoman, marriage therapist, divorce midwife, and motivational speaker. After Yaj speaks, she will be available to answer questions. So tonight, we're talking about from clueless to conscious, how communication makes or breaks any relationships. So, welcome Yaj.
Thank you for that fabulous introduction that I wrote, of course. Deb. You did so well. And thank you for having me finally in the garden at the Stone House that I've heard about for so long. I'm honored to finally be here and be with you lovely sister goddesses. This is gorgeous. Thank you for being here. So as you heard Deb say, perfect time. As you heard Deb say, I teach people how to communicate because most people aren't doing it right. And this is actually a much more common problem than you might think. But tonight, we're going to go over some steps that can clarify and empower your communication and make it safe anywhere you communicate. So I'm so passionate about conscious communication because I grew up in a family with two parents that were very unconscious in their relationship, very unconscious in their divorce, and very unconscious in the aftermath. And so it became a theme song of my life to overcome this and overcome the negative effects it had on me. And so I developed an internal mission to right the wrongs of my childhood, to heal all my pain, all my parents' pain, all the pain that their unconsciousness caused. And then when I got married and started running into intense emotional difficulties in my marriage, I just put that into my mission. That now I'm going to heal my marriage, and we're going to emotionally heal, and we're going to go out into the world and heal all the pain of the world. Hey, if you're going to be codependent, you might as well go for the big bucks, right? So I became a student of relationships and relationship problems. So professionally, I've been at it for 14 years. I've been at it romantically since I was 14, and really, I started noticing that I was bothered by and curious about relationships and relationship problems since my very first memory. So what is the number one thing you hear people say couples struggle with? I hear it all the time. Communication problems, right? This is what everybody says. I call it communication breakdowns. And what it means is that connection isn't happening where it could, and instead disconnection is happening. And everyone experiences communication breakdowns somewhere in their life, at some point, in some relationship. So, for example, the other day, maybe some of you can relate to this, I was on the phone with a lovely woman from India named Jane, on the phone representing United Healthcare. She just wasn't getting me. And she kept repeating what I know she thought was the answer to my question, but it wasn't. and she started calling me ma'am a lot and getting an edgy tone in her voice, and I wanted to kill her. Or on a more personal note, a friend is not getting the hint that you're just not interested in attending one of their evening sessions on the new line of skin products that they're selling, and you're running out of really compelling, urgent things that are prior commitments that make it impossible for you to go. You don't want to hurt her feelings, but you really don't want to go. What to do? But we all know the source of the hairiest, smelliest, darkest communication breakdowns that happen in our lives, don't we? Yes, it would be that personal love relationship. The mate, the date, the spouse, the potential hookup, the boyfriend, the girlfriend, that relationship. Damn, if it doesn't spawn some of the most annoying, mood-ruining, day-ruining, agitating communication breakdowns. Am I right, or what? Mm-hmm. Yeah? So, there's actually good reason for this. There's no one on the planet that we're projecting onto like that poor person. The expectations, the disappointments, it's intense. So when we focus on our communication in our personal relationships, we get really good material to work on. And when we do the work of having better communication in our personal relationships, the positive effects ripple out to all areas of our life. So the content in this talk applies to parenting, our own relationships with our parents, relationships with friends, colleagues, coworkers, anywhere we communicate. But I'm going to be focusing mostly on examples from the couples that I see in my private practice and what I've experienced personally. And maybe some of you will relate. So let's read the room. Let's find out how common communication breakdowns really are. How many of you have a relationship in your life that sometimes feels overwhelmingly difficult to handle? Thank you for being honest. How about ever lose your cool, calm exterior? Interior? And how about ever feel unseen, unheard, or misunderstood? It happens all the time. It's really the number one problem amongst humans, I think it's safe to say. And again, communication breakdowns are anything that causes disconnection instead of connection between two people. We probably have all heard that communication problems are what's cited probably most often as leading motives for divorce. And it's not just the couple that's affected by these bad communication habits. It's the children, and the effects can be devastating. In fact, psychologists who work with children and adolescents treating them for depression and anxiety often cite poor communication in the family. And then this poor communication goes out into the school, the community, the social setting, and affects the whole world. So we want to ask, why do communication problems happen? Two reasons: lack of skill and emotional reactivity. I'm going to teach you some skills later in this talk, so I want to focus on emotional reactivity right now and for a little while. Emotional reactivity is underneath pretty much all communication problems, unless they're purely technological, but even then, it's how we react more than just what's happening. Like when you get so mad at your computer, like offended by it, that you want to throw it out the window, take it personally. So it really is about our reactivity. A button gets pushed inside of us that's been there for a long time. It is rooted in defense mechanisms from childhood, beyond the scope of this talk, but that's what a trigger is. A button gets pushed and we respond, react, behave in self-protective but destructive ways, and it creates a mess. And we all have this emotional reactivity. And like I teach my clients, I'm going to teach you right now, that there's really just two faces of reactivity, like two sides of the coin, getting bigger and getting smaller. All reactivity comes underneath that. Attacking, criticizing, blaming, yelling, outwardly directed emotional or physical violence, retreating, withdrawing, shutting down, disappearing, inwardly directed emotional or physical violence, and passive aggression. So now we know why communication problems happen. But what are some examples of communication problems? Some of these might be familiar to you. So first, misunderstandings. You say something and it lands over there differently than how you meant it. Then the other person tends to react based on what they know you meant. Then you react to their reaction and we're off to the races. A conflict has erupted and can lead to a lot of hurt feelings in you and the other person. Next, no problem solving. This is where we see the disappearance of the willingness to sit down and talk it out. No more listening to the wise words of John Lennon. We can work it out. We can work it out. Gone. Here we will find fear of approaching one's partner. No communication at all, and sometimes even a dynamic of intimidation, which is very toxic indeed. Sometimes you'll see two people ignoring each other, but no problem solving is usually controlled by the person who doesn't want to talk, and there's someone else trying to talk, though their approach to try to talk may be way off. It does take two to tango. And then, of course, we have chronic conflict. Lots of fighting, fiery, hot, lots of reactivity, attack, counterattack, retreat until the next time. Chronic conflict creates an atmosphere of negativity in which it's virtually impossible to feel closeness. And if it does happen, then it's short-lived or unstable at best. The last one I'm going to detail out is kind of an old-fashioned term, but I wanted to include it. It's called Coventry. To send someone to Coventry, it's the silent treatment. Coventry is a place in England that was bombed heavily in World War II. I don't know if that has anything to do with it, but this is ignoring someone's existence for hours, days, weeks, months. My mother said that my father put her in Coventry for the whole summer before he left. I'm glad I don't remember. I was 3 and a half. Again, we sometimes will find two people ignoring each other, but when one person is doing it to another person on purpose to hurt them, it's a form of abuse. Sometimes we do it to survive and to protect ourselves, and so we have to do what we have to do to survive. But I wanted to detail it out. There's lots of other examples, it's infinite, but they all come under triggers, reactivity, and no problem solving. All communication problems come under them. And if left to become a pattern, communication breakdowns damage the trust in any relationship. If you can't trust someone, rely on someone to not only listen to you, but to care about what you have to say and your feelings, then that bond is very damaged. And if you're communicating in a way that they can't hear you, then that's your contribution to the breakdown. So there's work to do on both sides, but we can only take care of our part. Chronic patterns of communication do often lead to divorce, but really worse, they can lead to lifetimes of misery. Good communication is about increasing the trust and the closeness between people, or you could say trust and connection. And that's what it's all about. A brief word on affairs. Whenever the concept of trust comes up in the discussion of personal relationships, people tend to think about fidelity and infidelity. And certainly as a marriage therapist, I deal with affairs and this topic a lot. And it's beyond the scope of this talk to go into detail about that, but my fundamental message includes it. And my fundamental message is that no matter what, other than in cases of domestic violence, other forms of abuse, But I have to say, even in some of those scenarios, no matter what has occurred in your relationship, it's the thoughts that you allow to dominate your mind that lead to the worst pain and misery and breakdown. The thoughts that we believe are true about ourselves, about the other, about the relationship, about relationships, about the world, that can cause us the most suffering. And communication breakdowns, if left unidentified, unresolved, unrepaired, can cause such inner turmoil and angst that people develop actual symptoms. They get cranky, really irritable by the kids, the dog, the broken faucet. You know, they can lose their ability to concentrate, have poor job performance, lose their job, have financial problems, and actually develop physical symptoms, get ill, have anxiety, depression, even suicidal thoughts. And yes, divorce. But after that list, divorce doesn't sound so bad, does it? So, relationships are based on communication, and communication starts with the people you live with. How you answer the phone, how you talk to the UPS delivery person, or your pets. There's no way around it. Your communication skills start in your day-to-day life, and that's the place to practice. So consider this. You ask your partner to do something for you. They say yes, and they do it. But they really wanted to say no. But they didn't have the nerve. They didn't know they're allowed to say no. So you go on your merry day, clueless that your partner is now harboring a resentment towards you. Next thing you know, you're at the dinner table. And you say, honey, tonight, could you and the kids do the dishes? I have a business call. And you get, in front of the kids, it's always about you, you, you. When do I get to have something done for me? Stunned silence. Damage to the bond and the secure feeling in the home. Or this. You share something with a friend that was upsetting that happened between you and your mother. You didn't think to preface by saying, I'm really just needing to vent and I don't want advice. So you share your story, and when you're done, your friend says to you, well, what did you expect? She's a difficult person. You've been telling me that for years. Why do you keep doing this to yourself? You feel criticized, cut off, angry, and hurt. You decide never to share anything of personal import with this friend again. A distance grows. Next thing you know, a common acquaintance informs you that your friend's father died 3 months ago. Or how about this one? An old client of yours resurfaces. They make an appointment. Your fees are higher than the last time they've been in, but you don't mention it because they're an old client and you're grateful for their loyalty. They come in, see you, and it's not mentioned. Though your new fees are posted by the sign-in desk, the toilet paper roll, the coat rack. They pay you the old fee, thank you kindly for your services, and leave. Next thing you know, they refer a friend. I'm so glad I finally found someone I can afford. Kathy said your fees are the same as when she saw you 2 years ago. Thank you for being so kind. Now you have a reputation for being cheap. You're angry at yourself for not speaking up. You're angry at your old client, and you already resent the new client, and she's clueless. The examples are infinite. The problem is the same. Poor communication. George Bernard Shaw, a famous playwright, said this. The single biggest problem in communication is the illusion that it has occurred. We think we're communicating, but many times we're not. Tuning people out is another form of communication breakdown and happens quite often. And if you think about, well, why do people tune me out? Think about why you tune people out. And most people would answer, I'm bored. But I want to say here, bored is a very misunderstood and misused term. If we really examine it, quite often when we think we feel bored, we're feeling criticized or controlled. Maybe even just controlled by having to listen to a boring speaker. But we're feeling controlled. So what happens in couples, unfortunately, is they create a self-fulfilling prophecy. In fact, in most studies of marriages and divorce, men cite feeling nagged and complained about as their top communication complaint from their wives or partners. And women's top complaint is not feeling validated enough for their feelings and their opinions. So what happens so often is resentment just builds and silence is there like an iceberg, and it's a self-perpetuating dynamic and can become very difficult to turn around. Okay, this is kind of heavy, right? I've said a lot of really heavy stuff about communication. And some of you might be sitting here thinking, yeah, I get it. The world definitely needs this. There's tons of dysfunctional families out there, and there's still war. There's no peace in the Middle East. We definitely need to have better communication as human beings. But, I don't know, this is a pretty evolved crowd. Some of you might be sitting here thinking, I'm pretty evolved, I'm at the Stone House, I know Deb Zarella. I'm pretty good. My marriage, you know, I'm a good communicator. I don't really need to learn much more about communication. This may be so. But I humbly ask you to do this brave survey. Because rare is the being for whom no one has any difficulty communicating with. Pick a few key people in your life, and first you have to tell them you must have an honest answer for a personal growth assignment you're doing. And then ask them to answer this question. Where in your communication with me do you find any difficulty feeling heard, frustration, or feeling misunderstood? If they answer you honestly, which is a big if, you'll have some valuable material for your own personal growth path. Or maybe by now it may be getting quite clear to you just how bad the situation is with us humans in communication, including you. Maybe you're sitting here feeling painfully aware of how you contribute to some of the communication breakdowns in your life. Have no fear, you're not alone. I understand, and I'm here to help. Working directly with couples for 14 years and working very hard on a marriage that was riddled with communication breakdowns for the same amount of time, I've boiled down what works to some simple steps. I've seen pretty much everything in how communication can go wrong, terribly, terribly wrong. But my steps help things go right. And I've learned that by following a simple, reliable method, some structure, a lot can go right. There's hope. As I mentioned before, I grew up in what used to be called a broken home. And I realize this is a politically incorrect term now, but the truth is it does accurately describe how I felt growing up. My parents divorced when I was 3 and a half, and I have no memory of ever seeing them in the same room or speak to each other, even though I saw my father every Sunday for 13 years. They didn't speak. Zip. Zilch. Nada. How can the two people who created me hate each other so much that they can't even say hello? So way back then, I decided that when I grow up, I want to work with children of divorce because I know how they feel. And I want to help them to feel not broken. But in graduate school, studying family systems counseling, when I was introduced to Imago relationship therapy, the work of Dr. Farvel Hendricks and Dr. Helen LaKelly Hunt, I became really smitten with the structure of Imago dialogue. It made me feel emboldened to take on any problem in any couple, including in my own marriage. And I decided I want to work with couples. And I want to help them feel not broken and help them do less damage to their children. So even though my marriage is ending, we used formats and structures throughout our marriage, throughout the decision to separate, and we still use them to co-parent. So I am using the tools all throughout to remain a conscious communicator. And I'm really here, part of a very important message is that there are no failures in relationship if you're committed to being a conscious communicator. That's really what matters. I have a client story I'd like to share with you. There's a couple that I've been seeing for a few months, but early on when they started coming in. In one session, we used the format, we used the steps to help go over a trigger that one of them was feeling in the session. It was very successful, and they took the handout home. And a few days later, I got a call from the woman in the partnership saying that that morning, her partner had called very angry from work about something that had just happened. And she didn't want to join the negative energy like she had done in the past and get all derailed by it, but she wanted to be supportive. And it just so happened that the handout I had given them was right in front of her on the table. She started using it to walk her partner through his upset, and in just a few minutes, he was feeling so much better. By the time they got off the phone, he was ready to go into his workday, not only not upset and negative, but positive. Now, this was a very successful report, and she burst forth with all of these wonderful things. I'm so grateful for everything you're doing for us. Our relationship was on the rocks when we first came in to see you. You're giving us exactly what we need. This is amazing. And of course, that feels good to hear. But this couple is having these successes because they're receptive to the formats I'm teaching them. They use them at home. If that were you, what would you do? Would you have the courage, which is really just the willingness, to use a structure with your angry partner on the other end of the phone? Of course, there are some problems that communication skills can't fix. That's in my When to Run for the Hills speech. But there are so many problems better communication can at least help make better and not create a worse mess. I teach people that there's always a way to say anything responsibly, and I train them how to become what I call responsible communicators. There's rules, there's formats, there's structure. I get resistance to this sometimes, usually by the guys. I can say that in this audience, right? But, you know, how's what you've been doing working out for you, right? I usually follow the no sarcasm rule, but sometimes people need to get woken up with a slap upside the head. You're sitting in a couples therapist's office. Your partner has been upset for years and is afraid to speak to you about it. You feel the same way if you're willing to admit it. I'm here to show you the way out of misery and into connection. I know how. Are you willing to follow my instructions? Safe communication has form. Safe communication has structure. There's a method to avoid the madness. American novelist and playwright Don DeLillo said, "I slept for 4 years. I didn't study much of anything. I majored in something called communication arts." I strive to teach communication arts in a way that's interesting, fascinating, profound, colorful, challenging, but warm, safe, engaging. My office is a space in my home that I've sectioned off with bookshelves, wooden beads hanging, and beautiful Indian fabrics everywhere. I burn incense, I light candles, I play sacred music softly in the background. My clients and I sit on purple meditation cushions because my office has to match my hair. I don't spare anything in creating a comfy, cozy, healing ambiance. Magic happens in there. It's the Yaj pod. And clients practice what real communication actually feels like. They practice, they learn, they get heard. And they get all of this because they follow the rules of the pod. It's very, very helpful to have steps to follow to communicate, particularly when you're upset. It gives you something to rely on, an anchor, so you don't make a worse mess of it. So let's get into the pod, shall we? The pod method has 3 steps. P, pinpoint your perceptions. O, observe your opinions. D, dialogue or discretion. Start with P. P pinpoint your perceptions. Now, I know I said communication starts with the people you live with, but really, communication starts with yourself. If you don't know where you are on a matter, if you don't know how you feel about something, and you attempt to go into communication about it, you're liable to make it worse, particularly if you've been bothered by something. So your perceptions are your you are here map on any moment in your life. I feel this. I sense this. This is my truth. Dictionary.com says our perceptions are taken in through our senses and our mind. They are not just feelings, but include our immediate or intuitive recognition and insight. They are what we discern. A perception is a single, unified awareness derived from sensory processes while a stimulus is present. Sounds fancy. It means that something happens to you. There's a stimulus, something happens. And we're talking here mostly about triggers. So this can also be something positive. Oh my God, that felt so good. I think I'm in love. This tastes so good. I'm so happy. Keep as many of those as you can. Fan the flame on those. But we're talking here about when something happens and it's like, oh, you all know what I'm talking about, you're human beings. But we're talking about in relationship. Someone says something, someone did something, you were fine, and now you don't feel fine. So the important thing in this step is to pinpoint your perceptions in the moment. What am I picking up on? What am I feeling? What am I sensing? If you can name bodily sensations, it's very helpful. I started really getting aware of this years ago in the last time I saw an old friend when she said something to me in Washington Square Park, and I felt what afterwards I did a lot of work on it. In the moment when I look backwards, hindsight is 20/20, I really perceived something in my body. It was like an energy ripped through me that felt bad, and I didn't say anything. Had I been able to in the moment be present to my perceptions and say, whoa, 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 what you just said is landing on me negatively. Let's just pause. Whoa, right? And that's the idea, to be able to do it more in the moment, but at least to be able to do it with ourselves. So pinpoint your perceptions. Something happens. I use a sound effect now in my mind. Like if I feel a, I know something happened because I'm feeling it here. And I put a sound to it in my mind. Oh, I felt my Pay attention, I tell myself, pay attention, something just happened. Pinpoint my perceptions. Stay present to yourself. If you don't identify what you're sensing, again, you're more likely to make a mess. If you're triggered and then you try to talk about it, it's usually gonna go into one of those communication breakdowns that I mentioned earlier. Or you won't say anything and you'll go into a mess inside of yourself. It'll all go inward. Another client story. It really illustrates the value of pinpointing your perceptions before you communicate when you're triggered. A client of mine is doing some very, very good work. She's considering separating from her husband, but her main thing that she's working on is not operating out of guilt in her relationship, in her long-term marriage. So she's making great strides, but life always has a way of throwing us the next test, right? So recently, she was engaged in an activity that she was enjoying alone, and a text came in from her husband, and she perceived immediately that it felt like a manipulation to her, a thinly veiled manipulation masquerading as an offer. Her perception was clearly, no, I don't want to do that, but she'd become so addicted to allowing herself to be invisible in the marriage that she almost said yes right away. But she's a good student. So she stopped right in the middle of Home Depot, closed her eyes, and got in touch with what she was perceiving, and got clear that her answer was no, and declined his offer in her text back. And she immediately saw that had she said yes when she really wanted to say no, she would have been filled with anger and resentment toward herself and toward her husband. So she was so grateful that she listened to her instincts. Are you willing to practice this first step? No one has to know. You can do it invisibly, like Kegel exercises. So, I want to invite you all to think of a real current situation in your life, in a relationship, that's happening currently that bothers you. Just one. I don't know how long that's going to take you. Maybe you have to take some time to choose among, Maybe some of you have none. When you find one, tune into your body. Pinpoint two feeling words that you feel, that you perceive when you think about the situation. Just two. And make a simple statement in your mind. I feel blank and blank. That's it. That's all I'm asking you to do. Not about this. Just I feel sad and heavy. I feel hurt and lost. Just I feel blank and blank. That's it. Take a few moments. If you raise your hand and you have your statement, it's my no. And most of you, great. So good. You did step one. That's P, pinpoint your perceptions. You know how you now have your you are here map on this situation in your life. Now maybe you already knew this. Maybe you already knew these perceptions, but we're gonna keep moving forward. It's still good to identify your feelings that you already knew. And by the way, this is courageous work. I might be like, what's courageous? I just sat here in a chair and invisibly named two feelings in my head. It's courageous work because life becomes more risky when we acknowledge our feelings, even just to ourselves. By risky, I mean it becomes harder to betray or deceive ourselves if we're paying attention, more attention, to what we're really perceiving, our truth. And what made it hard for my client to say no right away to her husband's text was a paralyzing feeling of guilt that she's working on overcoming, and her self-criticism about her perception. So she knew her truth was no, and she immediately went into criticizing herself for wanting to say no. In fact, when she was telling me the story, she called herself a horrible person for wanting to say no. So this brings us into the second step. Oh, observe your opinions. So, many of us have heard that we gotta own our stuff, right? It's like everyone's saying, gotta own your stuff, gotta own my stuff. I can own that, I'm working on owning it, right? We've all heard this. But what does it mean? It means to recognize our triggers and our reactivity. That's what it means. So again, from my friend dictionary.com, opinions are beliefs or judgments, often critical, that are not based on sufficient evidence to be certain. And that's the rub right there. Because often when we're triggered, we have that perception of, and then we jump into thoughts, critical opinions, we believe them. And by the way, this all happens mostly subconsciously. But we start believing them, and that's where we really get ourselves more triggered and in more trouble. And that's where relationships go awry. So that's what causes the trigger, the thoughts, but really it's the believing the thoughts. Unidentified, our opinionated thoughts hijack our life, really. Another client story. A couple that I work with is so reactive with each other that if I didn't have these rules of the pod, they would constantly be interrupting each other, getting defensive, nitpicking, finishing each other's sentences, cutting each other off. I have to be really, really strict with them. But recently, they were in the middle of a dialogue, and I might have been looking down for 1 second, jotting down a brief note. I hardly take any notes at all. And all of a sudden, the person speaking said, did you see what they just did? I missed it. What I had missed was that the other person had looked away for a minute. And she says, you see, they don't care about what I'm saying. I never get heard. Why am I wasting my time? Now, consciousness and being present is the main work in Yajpat, but the reactivity, the anger, the hurt, the story that they were believing. Now, the person who had looked away for a moment owned their stuff and refocused on the dialogue, but not before their partner felt a re-triggering of not mattering, not being important, and attacked her partner for it. I'm sorry to say this kind of thing happens all the time. Often. So, let's practice this step. The way to do this step is to ask yourself, what is going on in my head right now? This is not about the body. That was the perceptions. Observing your opinions is just asking yourself, what is going on in my head right now? And seeing the beliefs, the conclusions, the declarative statements, the things we're so sure are true, like running through our head like a screensaver on a computer. So think about the situation you just pinpointed your perceptions about. And now ask yourself, what are some of the stories, the narratives, the beliefs, the opinions I have about me, the other person, the situation, particularly the more victim-y and blamey ones? We want to go for that one. And maybe you can even zero in on the big opinion you have about this. Go for the most victim-y or blamey one that you might believe sometimes. Kind of catch yourself. Lovingly, but like, yeah, I do that. I believe that. It's usually something you don't really want to admit. And I'm not going to make you do it out loud. Raise your hand when you got a smelly, suffering opinion that you have that causes you more unhappiness about the situation. This is the hardest step. This step is usually the most difficult. Let me give you some examples. He's ruining my life. That was mine with my ex. It doesn't have to be that bad. I always start with that one. You know, I'll never get heard. I'm wasting my time. You know, they're stupid. I'm stupid. You know, this is never gonna work. You know, he's just like my father. She's just like my mother. This sucks. It's not worth it. I can't take this. Why did I do this to myself again? You know, stuff like that. Does anyone have a few more? Any few more hands? Got a suffering story? Opinion? Good. This is really, truly the most difficult step. It happens often very unconsciously. And the truth is, we often have piles of stories about anything that's triggering us. If we're negatively triggered, we have stories. We have opinions about it. And this is an extremely important step. So at this point, you've pinpointed your perceptions about a situation in a relationship that bothers you, and you've observed your opinions. Now you might be ready to invite someone to talk with you. But all of this you can do in just a couple of moments with a little practice. So, D, dialogue or discretion. What do I mean by that? To communicate or not to communicate? That is the question. Now, sometimes it makes more sense not to communicate with someone about something. There's a lot of reasons why. That's fine. Sometimes it really is very useful to invite someone to communicate. That is your discernment. And I have to say, the universe was extremely generous with D words for the step in the pod method. You have a decision to make. I mean, it's ridiculous. You have a decision to make. You need to discern whether or not to dialogue or use discretion to bring dignity to the way you discuss something or to be discreet and remain silent on it. But even if you choose discretion, I highly encourage you to journal, to write it out somewhere, at least your perceptions and your opinions that you were able to identify. Then you've done that communication work with yourself and maybe the reason why you're choosing discretion. But we're going to focus on the times that you choose to dialogue, to discuss. Now, when I say dialogue, proper noun. Capital D dialogue. Imago dialogue is the main tool that I teach my clients. But it's beyond the talk today to teach you imago dialogue. And in any event, whether we're choosing to do formal dialogue or just bring dignity to how we discuss something, the rules are the same. The rules of responsible communication are the same. And I say, no matter what, we want to be dialogical, not diabolical. So what does it mean to be dialogical in our speech? It means to not send something in a way, to not say something in a way that the receiver is more likely to be defensive. to become super aware of how we might be landing over there and yet still speak our truth. It takes practice, but it's doable. And that's what I go deeply into coaching my private clients to do. Now, when they're doing an imago dialogue, we do this thing where we reflect back, we repeat back what the other person said, and the universe, again, dropped this one right in my lap. In imago land, we say, mirror, mirror the person back. I say something, you say it back. And then I thought, ditto, ditto it back. Another D for this last step, give them a copy back. It works perfectly. So what I'd like to do, first I wanted to say, I've been privy to countless times with couples when just dittoing back what someone said helps them avert disaster and create a higher level of conscious communication. Just this step. So if you never become a private client of mine or never learn full imago dialogue, you can take this with you and use it for the rest of your life, where you just say something back that you heard someone say. And you can ask first, can I ditto you, or can we do this thing called dittoing? Can we practice this? It's an amazing, things can happen. Are you willing to try it?
Yeah.
Thank you. So I'm actually going to invite one or two people to just have me ditto you. And you're just going to share the sentence you created when you pinpointed your perceptions, just so you get to see what dittoing looks like before you take it home and try it. So who's willing to have me ditto them? All you're going to share is the sentence that I feel blank and blank. That's it. If you want to share the opinion, the one opinion, you may do that too. Volunteers, anyone? You don't have to come up here. Great. Okay. So we're not going to do the intro. We're not going to do any of the whole big fancy stuff. You're just going to say your sentence. I feel blank and blank, and I'm going to ditto you back.
I feel blank and blank?
Well, yeah. You'll get the two feelings.
I feel unheard and unappreciated in life.
Leave off the in life and say it again.
I feel unheard and unappreciated.
You feel unheard and unappreciated. Did I get it?
Yes.
That's dittoing. There was a little coaching in there. See, I know how to wear both hats. This is what I do with my couples and my clients, my individual clients, because I want, for pinpoint, for this step, for this method, when you just pinpoint your perceptions and leave off anything after the feelings, practice it a few times, journal it, think it, try it, you'll see it packs more punch when you just name the perceptions and the feelings. It's not that the other stuff isn't important. That could come later in a longer dialogue. But when you just say, I feel angry and sad, it has a power to it. Like claiming, it's my truth, okay? Would you like to share, you don't have to, would you like to share your opinionated thought?
About myself.
That you came up with about the relationship. It would just be one, you know, one sentence.
Boy, I can't remember what it was.
That's okay. Maybe I can ask someone else.
So it's the opinion about...
Like that he's ruining my life, it's not worth it, this is never going to happen, I'm so stupid, he's so stupid, like just, that's what I'm looking for, like bam, okay. That's my big opinion.
I'm not smart enough.
You're not smart enough, is your opinion. Did I get it?
Yeah.
Good.
When I'm with this person.
Got it. Okay. When you're with you, yeah, we all get that. She's smart enough. When you're with this person, this opinion you have is you're not smart enough. Yeah, good. And you can see how believing that can cause suffering and can cause communication to go all over the place and can cause relationship problems and communication breakdowns. Yeah. That's dittoing. You just say it back, you change the pronoun. Now, imago dialogue goes on, there's more steps, but I just wanted to show you a little bit of what that was like. And even in just this little sample, oh no, someone else. Let's get another volunteer. Someone else willing to share, yeah. So your statement.
Frustrated.
You feel frustrated and annoyed. Did I get it? And would you like to share your opinion?
It's never gonna change.
It's never gonna change. Did I get it? Thank you. Very cool. So with just these two little samples, does anyone have any brief thing to share about seeing any value in doing this and imagining how it could possibly be valuable in a relationship where there's communication breakdown? Anybody?
Yeah.
Yeah, or how it felt to be mirrored.
Well,
dittoed.
What happens is you get to hear yourself talking out loud through another person particularly the person that you're having a problem with. And it's a really interesting response physiologically in my body to hear the person I'm having a problem with say exactly what my problem I interpreted, and it's like I'm being heard.
And oh, I didn't bring my bells. I have bells next to my... I ring bells when people say so. Yeah, thank you. Have you done this before? Have you done imago dialogue?
No. Well, I've done different
reflective
things,
listening.
But this is very, very specific.
Yeah.
And then to observe the person that's saying it, that I'm fighting with or disagreeing with, and watch their dynamics, I can just imagine that would be, like, interesting.
Fascinating, really.
Because everybody's downloading something, you know, because whatever I'm blocked about, they're blocked about, because I'm their mirror.
Right.
And whatever they're blocked about, I'm blocked about, because we're both mirrors.
Thank you. So what she's saying is, you know, there's certain things that I've led workshops and given talks on Imago Dialogue for many years, and there's always someone in the crowd that says the things that you're like, yes, I paid them $20 to say that before the talk, which is, I feel heard. And you're even, you know, imagining, you're thinking to things you've done, and even just imagining. That's the name of the game, getting heard. Everyone wants to feel heard, and these steps get you heard. First to yourself, I feel this, I sense this, I'm hearing myself. Oh, look at that big fat opinion I am buying into. Wow. How does it feel to notice this thought, these negative thoughts I'm having, and then if you choose to dialogue, to get heard. So even this little sample, our little sample here, gives insight into how this can be valuable. Just a taste of conscious communication is a revolution, you know? There's so much unconscious communication going on out there that anything conscious helps. I understand there may be questions about how to use this format. I'm happy to, you know, after the talk is over, to answer questions. Also, I have my email list. If you haven't signed up and want to, please sign up or just send me an email. And I want to offer today, just here today, to anyone that's here tonight, if you want to call me with questions about any of this and how to apply this in your lives, I'd be happy to just speak with you, you know, for a little bit on the phone, just as my gift to you for being in the garden at the Stone House. So, because I really, really want to help spread conscious communication. If there was a 350 of you, I couldn't offer that. But so that's the pod method. It's simple, but not easy if you're triggered. So the next time you're triggered, remember, you can get into the pod by pinpointing your perceptions, observing your opinions, and dialogue or discretion. I want to share a very personal story with you that helped me integrate and get grounded in this method before I knew that that's what was happening. So we've all heard that therapists become therapists to heal themselves, right? Or healers become healers to heal themselves. So what does that say about a relationship therapist's relationship? Relationships. Well, I was a mess myself. And I'm here today to tell you that I know these steps work because I've had to use them to survive. And I really learned on the front lines as a marriage and family therapist, but also in a very challenging, painful, and difficult marriage, that using a reliable method can avert disaster, keep me sane, and keep me safe, and actually allow me to continue to experience joy in my life no matter what else is happening. So, about 3 years ago, I was still in the phase of trying to save my marriage, which was riddled with all kinds of painful communication breakdowns, and isolation and despair and anything else you can kind of not want to imagine. But I still believed in the purpose of my marriage. I still had that drive to make my marriage be a beacon of healing, to heal all the pain of the world, like I mentioned before. I was zealous about it. So it's the summer of 2012, and it's about 10 o'clock at night, and I just came home with my husband, and we have just given a monthly event that we had been doing for a year and a half in our town in Rockland County. And the name of the event was The Relationship Miracle. Now, The Relationship Miracle was my brainchild. My daughter helped name it. And what it was that we would get in front of a live audience and demonstrate a real, full imago dialogue about an actual issue in our marriage, unrehearsed. Great idea, right? Mm-hmm. We had agreements to not blindside the other one, to not bring up certain topics ever in public, and to agree beforehand just on the general topic. So we would agree on the topic before going in, the general topic. Having no further discussion about it kept it fresh and better in front of a better show in front of a live audience. But even with these agreements, we often had actually our worst fights in our relationship often happened after the relationship miracle. So he's more sensitive than I am about airing private stuff publicly. I'm kind of more like I'm an open book. If it's in service, I don't get triggered by sharing, you know, within certain agreements, I don't get triggered by sharing pretty personal things, obviously. But he's different person over there in the relationship. And he would often have delayed reactions. And when he had reactions, they were very, very intense. So when this happens, I feel that if I could just shake it out of him, just snap him out of it, and we could do a dialogue and work through it and heal this, and it would be even more of a triumph, and then we could be even more of a beacon of healing for the world, and we could get back to that healing all the pain of the world through our marriage, right? Isn't codependency so not funny, it's not even a joke? So he's lying on the couch in agony. He can't talk. I can't bear looking at him in this state. I'm feeling my mission in life is failing, the big opinion, you know, my mission in life is failing to heal and be this beacon of healing in the world. So I am realizing I need to just get away. I need physical distance. Okay. So I wanted to say something first more about this mission. So back when I was a child in this household with my parents not speaking to each other, divorced, my mission became not just to help children when I grew up, which turned into helping couples. I developed this passionate desire to create a loving, intact, healthy, communicative family when I grew up, so I could get to experience it from that end if I wasn't going to get to experience it as a child, and so I could give that to my children. So that really became my passionate mission. So there's the crash of the disappointment when that's not happening in my marriage. So I need physical distance from him. I go upstairs, sit on the bed, and pick up a book I'm halfway through. The title of it is Journey of the Heart by John Wellwood. Happens to be one of the best relationship books I've ever read. And I just so happened to be on the part that was about separating feelings from thoughts, perceptions from opinions. Now, it's not that this was a new concept to me. You know, in Imago Dei, I was already an Imago therapist doing the relationship miracle. In Imago, we say the story I'm telling myself about that is. There's other things all over the place like this, but I was ripe for John Wellwood's lesson in that moment, the way he put it. So, my feelings, I had no problem identifying them once I started. I feel despair, I feel pain, I feel heavy, I feel dark, the tears start coming, I'm crying, I'm sobbing, and I'm saying these things out loud. He didn't say to do that, I just wanted to. I'm alone in the bedroom and I'm saying these things out loud, and I'm going, it's like unrolling, like a scroll. I feel despair, I feel bleak, I feel no problem identifying the perceptions. Then it went to the story, the opinions. No problem there. He's ruining my life. He always has. He always will. I'm trapped. I have to live like this. It's always going to be like this. I can never get out. Does any of this sound any familiar? Am I the only one? It's okay. I'll admit it. Whew. Pretty bad. I'm crying, but something starts to happen. As I say my feelings out loud, and keep naming the perceptions and the feelings, which was the instructions in the book, to focus on the perceptions, the feelings, the sensations in the body. The story, the image of him writhing in agony on the couch downstairs, this he's ruining my life, the I'm trapped here forever, starts fading away like in a movie, like when people drive away in a movie. It's a visceral experience. It starts disappearing and falling away till it, poof, is gone. And I'm left alone with my feelings, which were hard feelings to have, but cleaner, simpler. I could work with this. All of a sudden, he knocks on the door. He wants to talk. No, I'm not ready. I'm doing my work. I need to be alone. He retreats. He doesn't open the door. And I get more grounded in this experience of the story disappearing and me left with my feelings and the subsiding of the pain. And then I was ready to talk. This would be the dialogue or discretion. But I did both. I just shared that I invited him in, and I shared that I named all of the painful feelings I was having, and I told him, I identified my feelings and I identified my thoughts, and I feel better now. That's what I shared. I chose discretion on the feelings and the opinions. He was relieved, the energy was better, and that moment at least was better. And it was a real turning point for me in my life. It was a marking point, not only in the integration of this method, very simple, but it was also a turning point for me in my marriage when I let go of trying to force that as well. So I let go of the event. So we decided not to do the event anymore, duh, right? Like, duh. So we decided not to do the event anymore, and that hurt. You know, I didn't get what I wanted. That was a loss. But, you know, to force a thing. So it was really a very classic lesson for me, to let go of something when you're trying to force it. And it also helped me let go of my marriage, because I realized I was trying to force that too. The intensity of my denial that it just was impossible to have the marriage I wanted to have or to be happy in this marriage. So I let go of that too. So there's another part of the lesson is to not make him or anyone my enemy, right? No one is ruining my life unless I say so, no matter what. So that was pretty huge, and I still remember it, and it was 3 years ago. And I think I'll always remember that night. It's in my speech now, I'll always remember it. So I have struggled with very painful communication breakdowns, and I've used a format that has helped me feel better. My zealous commitment to being a conscious communicator is what gets me through, and what still gets me through, and helps me avoid despair and disaster and to feel joy to this day. How would you react in that situation? Now, I don't know if you have situations quite like that, but you might want to look at how do you react when someone's melting down in front of you, when you're melting down, you know, how you maybe contribute to a breakdown, how maybe you might be forcing something that is just not going to work. And what I'm offering you tonight is a very simple method that is reliable, repeatable, and that works, and will bring you clarity and peace and the ability to have love and strength and all the wonderful things that we want to have. And I know you can do it. Pinpoint your perceptions, observe your opinions, and dialogue or discretion when you feel triggered. I hope you're willing to try this in your life. Thank you for listening to my story. This experience that I had led to what I now call the pod method. And I know that everyone in this room has some difficulty somewhere, because you're human in relationship and in communication. We've all felt our boundaries crossed and either didn't speak up and let it go inside of us, or spoke up too abruptly and put someone off, or maybe we've crossed boundaries and didn't notice, or sloppily didn't clean it up. We all have these types of breakdowns. So, and it can feel very painful to not know what to do and to not have solutions. And I'm here to tell you that communication can be safe. It needs to be safe, and there's a way to make it safe. And that we don't have to suffer so much in relationships that in many, many cases, just improving communication can make a relationship a lot more comfortable. And the pod method is a great start. So I hope you're willing to get into the pod. Thank you so much for having me tonight. I appreciate you listening. I don't know if you want to allow me to take any questions or if there's time.
Absolutely.
Yeah, okay, so I could take, are there any questions? Yes, hi. I didn't take any water, I got in the zone, man. Don't worry, I'm going to ditto her.
This is one of the first things that she pointed out in the talk. They immediately take it in the wrong way.
So let me just ditto you. So this is great. Let me ditto you so far. So you're saying when you start communication with somebody and immediately they take you the wrong way. Is that what you said?
Right.
Meaning not how you intended it.
Right.
Okay.
So I can't, I don't know how to bring it back in and start over and erase what they thought.
And you know they're taking you other than how you meant it because their behavior, their facial expressions, what? They come out and say something where you know they didn't.
Yeah, they didn't
get you right.
Yeah.
So I'll give you, I'll give you a quick tip. And what's your name?
Nancy.
Nancy, take me up on my offer if you choose. Call me, and I'd love to go over this with you. I also have a sheet that I created for people. Clients whose partners were not with them in the counseling room. I call it stealth mission, being on a stealth mission or secret mission, how to use these tools when you don't have a willing dialogue partner. So I'd be happy to email you that document, but my quick, just down and dirty, go home and try this tonight if it happens, is it's so simple. It's the same stuff we already know and use in other contexts. It's just that things get so emotionally loaded in relationships that we don't think to use a thing we would use like at a baseball game or, a Monopoly game or, do over. Would it be all right if I just start that again? That's what I'm saying that you could say. So it's like, time out. Not like time out, right? Like, whoa, time out. Can I try that again? Because I think I'm not getting across. I think there's a misunderstanding happening. Like this, right? Like I said it. Not, you're not getting me, tone is huge, right? So can I try that again? I think there was just a rupture. I think there was just a disconnect. Would you be willing? I teach all my clients. Would you be willing to let me just do that over and start that again? You could even I don't like the way I put that. Like, can I start that again? Just that. Does that seem like something you can do?
Yes.
But? Oh, that's another tool. Yeah, let's sleep on it. Let's take five. Brilliant. Discretion. Dialogue. Discretion. It's a constant dance. It's not like one. In the middle of talking, you could be like, I'm feeling that maybe I think I want to breathe on this. Would it be all right? Would you be willing to just table this for tonight? Let's just enjoy, whatever. Or let's retreat to our corners and try again tomorrow, whatever the situation is. Absolutely, discretion. Let's, I'm choosing to, or please let's, or would you be willing to just stop? Let's just stop for now. Let's give it a break, give it a rest. It can be life-saving. You're welcome. Any other questions? Yes.
So I had a situation yesterday in just a work situation with someone I hardly ever, run into. I mean, it's just a random person.
Yeah.
And I felt shamed and blamed.
Yeah.
And what do you do in a situation like that?
Well, the thing is, I know the situation because you shared it with me. So if a stranger asked me that question, I'd probably have to get a little more information or I'd give a more general answer. But because I know the situation, I can answer it a little more specifically. But I just wanted to say that out loud so people know. So the way you told me that you did handle it, I thought was pretty good.
Okay.
What I would add would be, well, it's dialogue or discretion. Dialogue can just be talk, you know, just talk. Talk or discretion. It might be in that case, if there's authority, you know, if there's like, you know, something at stake that you don't want to risk, then it might be like just not say anything and just go do some reflective work with yourself later. But if you want, did you want to say something other than or more than what you said?
I went into defending myself, you know, and so then the shame started coming to me, like turning.
Yeah,
inward,
like now I have something to defend. Okay,
yeah.
So what I would suggest is something like, now you could tweak it because depending on who you're talking to, but something like, would you be willing to speak a little kinder, gentler, lower volume, slower? Would you be willing to shift a little bit the way you're speaking to me right now? So you try not to do it shaming back. Like, are you, you know, because where I would want to go is like, are you hearing the way you're talking to me right now? Like,
yeah.
Really? Like, really?
Yeah.
Are you hearing yourself? This is how you talk to people who you're working with?
Yeah.
Just gonna, right? But would you be willing to shift the way you're speaking? It's so I can really hear you, because I really want to hear what you have to say. Yeah. See, there's always this way.
Yeah.
You could say, oh, it's manipulative spinning. It's really not. It's connection. Communication is about creating more connection, not more disconnection.
Yeah.
So, and would you be willing? I can't take credit for it. It was actually my ex's imago trainer that trained everyone. And I was an assistant in his training. He did the full imago training. Would you be willing? I teach it to all my clients. I use it all the time. Would you be willing?
Yeah.
Just shift. Careful with the word tone.
Yeah.
With this scenario,
because
I don't have tone. You know,
yeah.
But would you be willing to just shift or speak at slightly lower volume so I can really hear you? Because I actually really want to hear the feedback you have for me.
Right.
That
would have
probably disarmed her a little bit.
Yeah. Because what I did
was like, what?
Got defensive and then just got the heck out of there and then felt victimized all day.
What she's pointing out is really interesting. Sometimes we feel we need to defend, and sometimes we kind of have to. But what you're pointing out is really brilliant, that if we go into defense, somewhere in us there's an opinion that we need to defend ourselves, that they're right and I'm wrong, as opposed to staying grounded in, I don't like the way you're talking to me right now. I don't invite being spoken to like this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's a more edgy way of doing it, but sometimes that's doable.
Mm-hmm.
And so when we go into defense, then later something can kick in like shame, like, oh, like it's just yucky to go into like feeling like you have to defend yourself. So, tools, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Is that helpful?
Yes, very helpful.
And I can totally picture you doing that.
Yes, yes.
You know, would you be willing? Yeah.
So what if they just say, no, I'm not going to lower my voice.
Right.
No,
so
I'm not going to take care of your needs. I'm taking care of mine.
Right. So you have to consider the source, consider the context, consider the situation. Maybe it's time to be like, okay, I'm quitting this job tomorrow. But I'm just, you know, or, you know, it might be, you know, this is the final nail in the coffin of my marriage. No, really.
No,
you know, or
I
it might be, I'm going to let it rest until tomorrow and I'm going to try this again. It depends on the situation.
Yeah.
I mean, you know what I'm saying? Like, it depends on the situation. Or it might be, you know, I don't invite being spoken to like this anywhere in my life. So I'm going to walk away. And if you have anything more, you know, you can email me and maybe we can try again another time. There's a host of things you can try.
Mm-hmm.
It depends on the situation.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because sometimes people will do that.
Oh, mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you just don't want to, because if you get all riled up and meet their aggression with aggression, you're going to make yourself sick.
Right.
You know? Really?
Well, you know what,
you don't want to do that. Oh, I have more questions popping up now. So I want to move on. Yes, Shelley.
Is there a place in communication for humor, like opposites attract. I'm always right and you're always wrong.
So up in the front here, Sister Goddess Shelley says, is there a place in communication for humor? Like, opposites attract, you know, I'm always right, you're always wrong. I will say this, a resounding yes to the first part of what you said. Humor, yes, be very careful with sarcasm.
With
sarcasm, like I said earlier in my talk, I usually follow the no sarcasm. But humor definitely can be a tension dispeller between two people. And once you're laughing, it's like, all right, now we can really problem solve. Yes, it's wise. Wisdom is humor. Humor is wisdom. Keep it a little lighter. Yes, ma'am.
What if you just take the higher road in a situation like that? You know what I'm saying? You don't have to agree with what they're saying and just take the higher road. Okay, and then...
Meaning, by take the higher road, meaning choose discretion, not say anything, know
absolutely.
That they're... Oh, I meant to say that. Know that they're a whack job.
Right, and just say, you know what?
I'm not going to engage in this.
You know what? It's their opinion, and like, do you really care what they think?
So yeah, that would come under...
I mean, really?
Yeah. So let's just keep it focused, because we're still videoing, and I want to wrap. And you know what? We can bring it to a close, and then we can all talk about it, because now it's like everything's warming up, right? So to take the higher road can be... this is actually very important, that sometimes you will be faced with someone who's crazy. She's crazy. Do you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like, to talk to someone like that.
Yeah.
In that kind of environment, she's...
But I still needed to... continue communication until I left there.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So one option is, all right, certifiable nut job, mm-hmm. that she thinks it's okay to talk to someone like this in this mm-hmm. setting. I'm just going to, you know, like, that really helps. It's not about, I don't want to send you off thinking my main message was, like, go out there and notice all the certifiable nut jobs. But let me tell you, sometimes it's really important to tell yourself, okay, this person is off. They're off. There's something not right. They're triggered. They're not. You're not in your sane mind when you're triggered. Crazy. Attacking, right? And then, you know, go about the rest of the day and then figure out what you want to do to take care of yourself, to take care of mm-hmm. if there's anything else you need to do. Yes, absolutely. Sometimes we just need to be
Just spin it.
There's so many things you can do. Well, that is sort of a spin, what I originally suggested. Like, you know, I really want to hear... what your feedback, actually. I really, you know, I've been following your work for years or whatever, and I actually really value your feedback. It's just, you know, I'm having a hard time keeping up with everything you're saying because the words are coming so fast. Would you be willing to slow down a little bit? It could disarm somebody, and that's spinning it. I mean, you just want some tools on your belt to whip out. Mm-hmm. So thank you so much, and let's, you know, keep the conversation alive.